In this video, one in a series, I take a look at redox reactions in aqueous solution. So I'll begin by briefly outlining how we use so-called E-theta values or reduction potentials to build up a redox reaction. A redox reaction comprises of two so-called half equations which you join or couple together. Both half equations should initially be written as reduction reactions, that's to say with electrons on the left-hand side. Before coupling two half equations, we need to determine which has the larger reduction potential. So their reduction potentials, which by the way are temperature dependent, should be written next to them. And as we go through the video, I'll write the E theta values or reduction potentials to the right. Here's an example. We have the half equation for the reduction of dichromate ions, where the chromium is present on the left in the +6 oxidation state and +3 on the right. And you can see that its reduction potential, or E theta value, is +1.33. That should be volts. And below it there we have the half equation for the reduction of iron 3 plus to iron 2 plus with an E theta value of +0.77 volts. So what do we do with these half equations to produce a redox equation? Well, first, the half equation with the largest E theta value does undergo reduction. It has, after all, the greater reduction potential. And since oxidation and reduction always occur together, that means that the half equation with the lowest reduction potential needs to be reversed and presented as oxidation instead. So reverse the equation, or the half equation, with the lower reduction potential. So the half equation for the reduction of dichromate ions stays as is because it has the larger reduction potential, and you reverse the other one. So we'll bring the Fe2 plus ions to the left hand side and the Fe3 plus and electrons to the right hand side. It's necessary to have the same number of electrons in both half equations, so that bottom half equation will need to be multiplied by 6 right across in order to balance electrons before you proceed to add the left hand sides of both together and the right hand sides of both together. And having balanced the electrons in the two half equations, we can now cancel the electrons and then simply add the two right hand sides together, and there we have the balanced redox reaction. If you were to create an electrochemical cell by coupling these two half cells or two half cell reactions, there's the voltage +0.56 volts. If you've done it correctly, the EMF should always turn out to be positive. Next, let me take a look at rust and rust protection by way of explaining how we deal with three or more half equations or half cell reactions in the same system. In other words, which two do we choose to couple and why? Of course, rust is actually hydrated iron 3 oxide, and for simplicity I've taken the half equation for the reduction of iron 2 to iron. Now, circled is the important half equation that you may not be familiar with. In rainwater with the dissolved air, including carbon dioxide, you're going to have dissolved oxygen, and the CO2 will dissolve to form a weak solution of carbonic acid. So on the left there of that half equation, you've got both oxygen and hydrogen ions. Now, even on the most polished surface of metal, you're going to have little pits and valleys like this, and the rainwater will get in there. The rainwater, that is, with the dissolved air, including carbon dioxide, and the carbon dioxide will have reacted to form hydrogen ions in solution, a weak solution of carbonic acid. So you can see, if you look at that half equation again then, oxygen on the left together with hydrogen ions from the carbonic acid and water on the right. So in my simple diagram here, we've got the metal iron, and in that little pit on the surface you've got some water trapped with dissolved oxygen and hydrogen ions from the CO2 that has both dissolved and dissociated to a small extent to produce hydrogen ions. Now, its E theta value is +1.23 volts, so it has a higher reduction potential, a very much higher reduction potential than that of the iron 2 to iron half cell. So which one's going to undergo reduction? It's going to be the lower one, involving oxygen and hydrogen ions forming water. That means that we have to reverse this one. So we'll have iron, instead of undergoing reduction, it'll undergo oxidation as shown here. Again, you would make sure the electrons are balanced. In this case, we have two electrons in both half equations. So having reversed the iron half equation, we simply now would add the two left-hand sides together and the two right-hand sides together. And you can see why iron rusts under these circumstances. Next then, let's take a look at rust protection using zinc in a process known as galvanizing, of course. This will introduce a third half equation, the half equation for the reduction of zinc 2 plus ions to zinc. There it is. And you can see it has an e-theta value of minus 0.76. That makes it lower than both of the other half equations. And that's going to be of significance. So there we have the three half equations. The one with the largest reduction potential is the one in the middle, plus 1.23 volts. And the one with the lowest reduction potential is the one at the bottom, the zinc half equation. Now in this circumstance where we have three or more different half equations present in the same system, or half cell reactions in the same system, what we find happens is that the two extremes are coupled. In this case, the one in the middle with the largest reduction potential couples with the one at the bottom, which has the lowest reduction potential. In other words, we have electrons moving from a region of lowest electron potential to a region of highest electron potential. So the iron, so to speak, plays piggy in the middle, and nothing happens to it. And this means that the zinc effectively protects the iron. So in the diagram here, if we add a layer of zinc, even when the iron is scraped, so that the iron, as you can see there, is exposed, then we have a situation where these three half-cell reactions come into play. The zinc itself, you can see, will be protected by a layer of zinc oxide, but once the zinc galvanized coating is scraped, you see here in this particular region, you're going to have all three half equations meeting in the same place. So even in this circumstance where the iron has become exposed, the zinc continues to protect it. So we couple these two half equations, the one in the middle with the one at the bottom, and that produces effectively an electrochemical cell. So in these circumstances, it can be understood as an electrochemical cell being set up with iron being protected as a result. So you can see then that the zinc is being sacrificed to protect the iron. And in electrochemistry, we use the terms sacrificial anode and or cathodic protection. So that's what you do when you have got three or more different electrochemical cells. So now we're ready to apply this electrochemistry knowledge to get a better understanding of what might be going on in solutions of transition metal compounds. In half equations 1 and 2 there, you see we have titanium in different oxidation states. In number 3, we've got that half equation again that you'll always have present in any aqueous solution, including aqueous solutions of transition metal compounds, with an e-theta value of plus 1.23 volts. Remember, that's because the water in the aqueous solution will have dissolved air, which will include CO2 at the very least, which will form a weak solution of carbonic acid and provide those hydrogen ions. By comparing the e-theta values for 1 and 3, you can see that number 1 has a lower reduction potential, and that can be used to explain why Ti2 plus ions are readily oxidized in aqueous solution to Ti3 plus. That means that Ti2 plus ions in aqueous solution are a source of electrons, making Ti2 plus aqueous solutions strong reducing agents. Number 2 as well has a lower reduction potential than number 3, and that can be used to explain why Ti3 plus ions in aqueous solution will be oxidized readily to the plus 4 oxidation state in the form of TiO with a 2 plus charge. So that means aqueous solutions of Ti2 plus, this is what's going on. You're going to have half equation number 3 moving from left to right, and the Ti2 plus ions will initially be oxidized to Ti3 plus but then further from Ti3 plus to the plus 4 oxidation state in TiO with the 2 plus charge. Next, let's consider what would happen if we introduce metallic zinc into these titanium ion solutions. You can see that half equation number 2 there has a higher reduction potential than number 4. So that means if we have those coupled together, the zinc has a lower reduction potential and will undergo oxidation and will go from zinc, metallic atoms of zinc, to zinc ions. And it means the titanium in its plus 4 oxidation state will be reduced to Ti3 plus. But do notice the requirement for acid there, because in equation number 2 you see we have hydrogen ions on the left, so the zinc will have to be assisted with something like sulfuric acid, dilute sulfuric acid. And if we look a stage further at half equation number 1, we see that it again has a higher reduction potential than number 4, which means in fact that zinc will reduce Ti with a plus 4 oxidation state through initially to Ti3 plus, but further reduce it to Ti2 plus. And if you were to take tin in place of zinc, you can see there that the tin 2 plus to tin half equation has an e-theta value of minus 0.14 volts. So hopefully you can see that tin would reduce Ti from its plus 4 to its plus 3 oxidation state, but not to the plus 2 oxidation state. Let's move on and take a look at some of the redox chemistry of vanadium. You might be familiar with this chemical, ammonium vanadate, where we have the VO3 ion with a single minus charge. And in that compound, vanadium appears in the plus 5 oxidation state. Interestingly here, in the first half equation, we have VO2 with a plus charge, and there are two vanadium appears in the plus 5 oxidation state, being reduced from plus 5 to plus 4 on the right, e-theta value 1.00 volts. Now, in VO2 with a single positive charge, that plus 5 oxidation state, it's yellow, forms yellow solutions like that on the left. And when oxidized to VO with a 2 plus charge, which is present in the plus 4 oxidation state, it appears blue in colour like this on the right. Now the second half equation shows the plus 4 oxidation state, that blue coloured solution, reduced to the plus 3 in the vanadium 3 plus ion. And those solutions appear green in colour, like that. Again, moving to the third half equation, it's possible to reduce the plus 3 further to plus 2, and it'll go from that green colour to a violet colour, like this. Next, let's consider the redox chemistry that might take place in such solutions if we were to add zinc or tin or nitric acid to the solution. So there we have six different half equations that we are going to apply those electrochemistry rules to. Look at number 4 there for zinc. It has a lower reduction potential than 1, 2 and 3. And if you pause for a minute, that explains why zinc and sulfuric acid together reduce vanadium 5 to vanadium 2. Again, the reasoning is that because the half equation number 4 there has a lower reduction potential than the 3 above it, it means that when coupled with any of those half equations, the zinc will in fact undergo oxidation and the others will undergo reduction as written. So all the way from vanadium plus 5 down to vanadium plus 2. All the way from the yellow down to the violet. Next, let's take a look at the use of tin, and therefore half equation number 5. You can see that 5 has a lower reduction potential than 1 and 2, but not 3. So this would explain why tin with sulfuric acid will reduce vanadium 5 down to vanadium 3, from yellow to blue and then to green, but will not oxidize it down to the plus 2 violet state. And what about nitric acid on its own? Look at half equation number 6. You can see it has an e theta value of plus 0.96 volts. So nitric acid has a larger reduction potential than both 2 and 3. Which would explain why it will oxidize plus 2 to plus 3 or plus 3 to plus 4, but not plus 4 to plus 5. So that's some redox chemistry associated with the complexes of vanadium. Let's move on then and take a look at some redox chemistry associated with chromium and the production of chrome alum crystals. And there's a half equation you've seen before for the reduction of dichromate ions to chromium 3. E theta value very large, plus 1.33 volts, as you would expect for a strong oxidizing agent. It's going to have a high potential to undergo reduction. So there in the dichromate ion we have the plus 6 oxidation state, and there plus 3. Second equation going from plus 3 to plus 2. We can consider the effect or influence of adding zinc to such solutions. And again, the half equation there for zinc has an E theta value of minus 0.76 volts. So you can see it has a lower reduction potential than both the other two. Let's consider coupling then the first with the third. And again, zinc has the lower reduction potential, so it'll undergo oxidation and the equation is reversed. And then you add the two half equations having balanced the electrons, so I've gone ahead and done that. You need to multiply the zinc half equation by 3 to balance up the electrons, hence you get 3 ZNs there on the left and 3 ZN2 pluses on the right. So if you were to warm a potassium dichromate solution with metallic zinc, you would expect it to be reduced at least to the plus 3 oxidation state. Let's consider whether it would be reduced further to plus 2. So we couple the second and third half equations, and again, because the zinc half equation has a lower reduction potential, then chromium 3 will indeed be reduced to chromium 2. And that's a blue coloured solution, as you see there, chromium 2. So you'll go from the orange dichromate to the dark green chromium 3, and then further to that blue coloured chromium 2 solution. And while we're dealing with chromium redox chemistry, perhaps worth taking a moment to take a look at the preparation of chrome alum crystals. You can see the formula there. Now you can do this using ethanol as the reducing agent. Let's take a look at the equation here, and it is an equilibrium equation. We have 3 moles of ethanol reacting in acidic solution with the dichromate ions. The ethanol is oxidized to the aldehyde ethanol, and the dichromate ions are reduced to chromium 3, so from the plus 6 to the plus 3 oxidation state. So let's see how we end up getting chrome alum crystals. And I've produced a separate video here on the YouTube channel that looks at the preparation in detail, and indeed takes a look down a microscope at the crystals forming. You see, the proper name of chrome alum crystals is hydrated chromium 3 potassium sulfate. So you begin by taking 100 cubic centimeters of deionized water in a beaker, and you slowly add in 10 cubic centimeters of concentrated sulfuric acid. You then warm and stir in 15 grams of potassium dichromate solid. When we are writing acidified potassium dichromate, we can write it like this: Cr2O7 2- H+, where the H+ represents the acid. There again is the half equation, and its E theta value plus 1.33 volts. And you can see that the dichromate ions are being reduced to chromium 3. So having stirred in the potassium dichromate, you then place the solution in an ice water bath to keep it below 20 degrees C, and that's to prevent the chromium 3 sulfate separating out. You're then ready to begin adding slowly 5 cubic centimeters of ethanol from a separating funnel. It does take around about 10 minutes to ensure that the temperature remains below 20 degrees C. And if you simply leave that solution to sit, you'll get your purple coloured crystals form. Okay, moving on finally to some redox chemistry associated with copper. And this is an example of a disproportionation reaction where a single substance is both oxidized and reduced. So have a look at this disproportionation reaction involving copper 1 ions on the left in the form of copper 1 oxide with dilute sulfuric acid. And on the right, you'll see that both copper, elemental copper, and copper 2 sulfate are formed. So copper 1 oxide is a brick red coloured solid. Copper, of course, is a pinky brown coloured solid. And aqueous copper sulfate, copper 2 sulfate, is a blue solution. Let's consider the redox chemistry taking place here and see if we can use E theta values to explain why this happens in solution. So I'm going to leave out the sulfate ions because the sulfate ions, you can see, don't change from left to right. And we've got an ionic equation instead. So get rid of the sulfate ions and we have an ionic equation here. Helps us to see what's going on better. Let's take a look at the reduction element of this disproportionation reaction. We've got copper in the plus 1 oxidation state there going to elemental copper with an oxidation state 0, so that's reduction since the oxidation number is being reduced. And it's also going to copper 2 plus ions, so rising from plus 1 to plus 2 oxidation number, that's oxidation. So reduction and oxidation together. Let's look at the half equations and their E theta values. So the reduction from copper 2 plus to copper plus 0.15 volts. The reduction of copper plus to copper atoms plus 0.52 volts. Which has the greater reduction potential? The bottom one. So you can actually couple these two half equations, but you'll have to reverse that one that has the lower reduction potential. Let's do that, see what we get. The electrons are already balanced and will cancel on both sides, and that's what we end up with. It has a positive EMF, as it should have if it's done correctly, and you can see indeed that the copper plus ions are both oxidized and reduced. An example of a disproportionation reaction. You can see where the Cu plus ions are coming from, highlighted in yellow there, where the metallic copper is coming from, and finally the Cu2 plus ions. So that covers some of the redox chemistry aspects of metal complexes in aqueous solution. Thanks for listening.